In addition to supplying our food, these four systems provide virtually all the raw materials for industry except minerals and petroleum-derived synthetics. So, apart from minerals and petroleum products, rest all the raw materials are being provided by these ecosystems, these four biological systems. So, in large areas of the world, human claims on these systems are reaching an unsustainable level, a point where their productivity is being impaired. So, finally, we have been interfering in all these biological systems at a larger scale so that we can develop our economies in to move further, to grow them further, so that, and that is what is making that new heights of economic growth is being the reason for exploiting these biological systems, and that is how the productivity is being impaired because of these economic activities. When this happens, fisheries collapse, forests disappear, grasslands are converted into barren wastelands, and croplands deteriorate. So, our various human activities, where they are leading to, what they are, what are the consequences of those exaggerated economic activities, economic development and exploitation, is these are the four consequences which we can see here. That is, the fisheries, they are collapsing, there are no further breeding of fishes, and the areas where there were fishes were in abundance, now there are no fishes to be, hardly they are able to make out the fishes to be fished from those fisheries. So, they are been collapsing. Similarly, the forests are disappearing. There is a massive deforestation which has been going on, and the grasslands are converted into barren wastelands. So, these wastelands gradually and slowly will convert to deserts. So, now they are of no use, and the croplands, they are deteriorating. The fertility of the land, the croplands, they are been deteriorating, and that is reducing the crop production. Now, in a protein conscious and protein hungry world, overfishing is common every day. In a protein conscious and protein hungry world, overfishing is common every day. In poor countries, local forests are being decimated in order to procure firewood for cooking. Now, what exactly has been happening? That our diet, to be, make it more healthier, we are more consuming, like the consumption of the protein has increased, and the best source of protein is being found in fishes. So, that is why the fisheries are being exploited a lot. Similarly, those countries which are poor, where the resources, their economies are weak, the people, they are destroying, decimated means they are destroying the forest for the firewood, for as a fuel for cooking. So, that is another reason why the forests are being depleting. In some places, firewood has become so expensive that what was under the pot now costs more than what's inside it. What this particular saying is being, that the things which are being cooked, the food which is being cooked is not that expensive, but the fuel which is being used, that is the firewood, has become even more costlier than the food which we are consuming. So, that is making us realize that destroying the forest for the firewood is not the right set of activity which should be it should be, rather it should be discarded. We should not use firewood. Since the tropical forest is, in the word of Dr. Mayers, the powerhouse of evolution. So without forest, the complete evolutionary journey of the earth will be destroyed, it will be diminished, and we will not be able to move further in our evolution. So several species of life face extinction as a result of its destruction. So destruction of those forests is leading towards the extinction of various life forms because they have been dependent on those forests. It has been well said that forests precede mankind, deserts follow. So wherever mankind goes, earlier there used to be a forest, and whenever mankind, when they inhabited that area, those forests they convert into deserts. So this is the impact of human activities. The world's ancient patrimony of tropical forests is now eroding in the rate of 40 to 50 million acres a year, and the growing use of dung for burning deprives the soil of an important natural fertilizer. So there are two ways in which we are depleting the nature. That is, one is the tropical forests, they are been eroding, the deforestation rate has been somewhere around 40 to 50 million acres a year, and this is an old data, rather we now it has been even exceeded further. And the cow dung, which has been used as the cow dung cake used as fuel, is basically depriving the soil. The soil does not get its humus because the cow dung is just been burned, or it has been used as fuel for cooking. So that is why the natural fertilizer is not being provided to the soil, and that is how the top layer of the soil is been deteriorating in the fertility. So the World Bank estimates that a five-fold increase in the rate of forest planting is needed to cope with the expected fuel wood demand in year 2000. Since this article was been published quite back, so that is why there the estimation is being given for the year 2000. Now it has all been exceeded further. So James Pitt, the president of World Resources Institute, said the other day, and what he said, we were saying that we are losing the forest at an acre a second. That is the rate at which the forest, the deforestation is going on. That means an acre a second. But it is much closer to an acre and a half to a second. So that means they are estimating that it will increase by many folds and it will become an acre and a half. So that is how it is exceeding. Okay. So these were the concerns which were being shared by James Spitt. Now let us move to the where is the scenario in India. Article 48A of Constitution of India provides that the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and the wildlife of the country. So our constitution has given, there is a law, Article 48, which talks about the conservation of environment and to safeguard, to preserve the forest and the wildlife of the country, and this is the responsibility, the onus goes to the states. But what causes endless anguish is the fact that laws are never respected or enforced in India. So this is a major issue, that the laws are being made but they are not being enforced. That is why lots of deterioration on the deforestation and other activities are being taken which are not environment friendly, they are not contributing towards the conservation and preservation of our environment. A recent report of our Parliament's Estimates Committee has highlighted the near catastrophic depletion of India's forests over the last 4 decades. So, we have already been doing this damage on a very intensely destructive reduction is been there, that is what is catastrophic depletion, which has been seen from last 4 decades, and India has been losing a vast stretch of forests. So, now what exactly we have to do here? India, according to reliable data, is losing its forest at the rate of 3.7 million acres a year. So, it is a massive rate of forest depletion. Now, it has even been increased now up till now. Large areas officially designated as forest land are already virtually treeless. So, though we consider various acres and acres of land and the forest, but actually if we see going over there, practically we will find those are already been deforested and they have become treeless areas. So, only the land has been still there under the forest areas. So, that is where we need to rehabilitate, we need to make afforestation activity to be taken up at a massive scale so that we can revive the health of our Indian forests. The actual loss of forest is estimated to be about 8 times the rate indicated by government statistics. So, the government statistics are at times are not being giving the actual statistics, and the actual statistics if we consider are very alarming, very frightening. A 3-year study using satellites and aerial photography conducted by United Nations warns that the environment has deteriorated so badly that it is critical in many of 88 countries investigated. So, finally, United Nations has come up with an investigation of that investigation took 3 years, and finally, they have identified that there are 88 countries which are critical with respect to the environmental health. They have been deteriorated, the environment has deteriorated badly in these countries. So, now there can be no doubt that the growth of world population is one of the strongest factors distorting the future of human society. So, as we are growing, the population has been growing, and that is the major factor which is responsible for the deterioration of our planet. And since the population is growing, the needs of that population is burdening the natural resources of the world. So, that was the world population around year 1800. By the year 1900, a second billion was added. So, first billion took up till year 1800, there were only 1 billion population. And by the next 100, another 1 more billion was been added. And the 20th century has added 3.7 billion of population to the world. The present world population is estimated at 5.7, and now this data has further increased. Every 4 days, the world population increases by 1 million. So, that is the rate by which it has been increasing. Fertility falls as incomes rises, education spreads, and health improves. So, basically, the growth and the improvement which comes in the human population is being paid, the price is being paid by the fertility fall. And thus, the development is the best contraceptive. But development itself may not be possible if present increase in numbers continues. So what it is saying is that if we want to control the population, sir, iska effect aaya, fertility falls as incomes rises, education spreads and health improves. So if we want to work out in controlling the population, we have to basically work on the development of our population. And if we move towards a developed set of human population, it assures the best to be the best contraceptive. So but development itself may not be possible if present increase in number continues. So it is very difficult, the rate at which we are been growing in the population is growing, it is very difficult to attain that status of development. So finally we are still there at the same situation where the situation has been very alarming. The rich get richer and the poor beget children, which condemn them to remain poor. So finally this is this imbalance of the economies, where the riches are, there is a rich section and the poor section of the society, and they are moving towards the extremes. More children does not mean more workers, merely more people without work. The concept is that certain people, they have their concept that if they have more children, it results in more workers, but it doesn't happen like that. Actually it results in more people who are unemployed without work. It is not suggested that human beings be treated like cattle and compulsorily sterilized. So this is not a right way of doing this, like compulsory sterilization is not the right way we should treat human beings. But there is no alternative to voluntary family planning without introducing an element of coercion, and the choice is really between the control of population and perpetuation of poverty. So if we want to bring down the levels of poverty, if we want to make the population to develop economically, and that then we need to have a choice, then we have to control the population. So population control is a major aspect which we have to take up. The population of India is estimated to be 920 million today. So this is an old data here. More than the entire populations of Africa and South America put together. So that is what is the massive population size of India. We all are aware about that. No one familiar with the conditions in India would doubt that the hope of people would die in their hungry huntment unless population control is given topmost priority. So the topmost requirement of India, with the measure for which we need to take up at a very prompt manner, is bringing the population to be controlled. For the first time in human history, we see a transcending concern, the survival not just of people but of the planet. So there is a shift which is coming up, that means that it is going beyond the narrow interest. That shift is transcending concern, means the concept of going beyond the narrow interest. So now people have shifting from just survival to the planet health. Basically they are now being considered considering the planet health to be of their priority. Now we have begun to take a holistic view of the very basis of our existence. So with that holistic view, we have transformed the way we are taking up various activities. The environmental problem does not necessarily signal our demise, it is our passport for the future. So the way we are basically dealing with that environmental problem is going to make us understand that how we are going to progress in our future. The emerging new world vision has urged in the era of responsibility. So now the population has become more responsible, the governments have become more responsible. Now they are understanding their obligations towards the mother nature. It is a holistic view and ecological view, seeing the world as an integrated whole rather than a dissociated collection of parts. So now with an overall holistic view, we are considering the environment of the complete world within with this shift, and finally everybody is been focusing on those activities which is going to finally rehabilitate the environment, the ailing environment of the earth. Industry has a most crucial role to play in this new era of responsibility. So the way we take up our industrialization further is been an important aspect of this responsibility which we are now taking up in this new era. What a transformation would be effected if more businessmen shared the view of the chairman of DuPont, Mr. Edgar S. Woolard, who 5 years ago declared himself to be the company's chief environmental officer. So the concept, the way the paradigm shift was being brought by the chairman of DuPont, making himself to be declared as chief environmental officer rather than the chief executive officer of the company. This view should be shared by other entrepreneurs and the business owners, so that we can bring this environment conservation and preservation concept to be brought into our business and economic activities. He said, "Our continued existence as a leading manufacturer requires that we excel in environmental performances." So what we need to do is, we need to excel in environmental performances in order to continue the existence as a leading manufacturer. So that is what the paradigm shift he brought in his business. Of all the statements made by Margaret Thatcher during the years of her prime ministership, none has passed so decisively into the current coin of English usage as her felicitous words, "No generation has a freehold on this earth." We do not have all rights on this earth. All we have is a life tenancy with a full repairing lease. What we are here, we are a tenant on this Mother Earth. We are here for just mere 70 to 80 years of our life, and we are being hiring, we are tenant over here. And what we are here for, the responsibility being here on this earth, is a full repairing lease. We have to repair this Mother Earth being on the earth for this duration of whatever the life we have got. So that is what is our responsibility. In the words of Mr. Lester Brown, what Mr. Lester Brown have shared here is, "We have not inherited this earth from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from our children." What he is saying is, we are the borrowers. We have to give it back to our future generations, to our children. Rather, this we are not inheriting. This is not a property. We are rather being tenant here. So we have to give it back. We have to submit it to our future generation. And this is where our responsibility comes, that we should repair it, rehabilitate it, revive the health of our planet before forwarding it, before giving it as a legacy to our future generation. So this was the various broader concepts which we wanted to bring in front of you from this chapter, and Naini Palkhiwala has done it wonderfully through this article, been published long back, but still it has been relevant in today's scenario also. So students, I would suggest you please go through the chapter very thoroughly through, and go through the video as well as complete the PDF, and whatever queries come, we will sort it out.